Welcome back to sickness. Last time we started this part with our main character randomly murdering his boss. And now we're getting home and I'm curious what will happen now. So, let's get the party started. Well, can I even call that a choice? As soon as I entered my temporary home, I noticed a pleasant scent coming from the kitchen. Filling my nose, I traced the source of the scent back to the chef of the household, who immediately ran over to my side. Ah, welcome back. I thought it was about time for you to get home. I've been waiting all afternoon. The young girl waiting for me was Sarah, my twin sister. Why are you calling her a young girl then, if she's your twin sister? But okay, the only family I have left. And like me, Sarah is still in school. Okay. Is still in school, so she's been getting home a few hours earlier than I have lately, giving her ample time to take care of the household chores. Kind, gentle, dependable, smart. Sarah is the image of an ideal little sister, one without whom I'd have never made it this far. I'm not that late, am I? Not at all. In fact, you're just in time. In time? In time for what? Given my first observation upon entering the house, I already had a good idea of what awaited me. However, even with Sarah standing before me while wearing an apron, something didn't seem right. In a house with few appliances and shelves stocked with cheap instant food, my sister, who had never cooked for me before, had somehow whipped up a proper meal in anticipation of my return. I could ignore the fact that this house smells like real food for once, but where on earth did the ingredients and utensils come from? Since Sarah and I began living on our own, we've been eating instant food every day, unable to afford anything better. You don't look like that at all. At least your sister doesn't look like she's eating instant food every single day. I'm sorry, but instant food leads to bad skin and normally, let's say, a bit bigger body than this. But yeah. With the petty cash we had left, there's no way Sarah could have bought any of this. In the saucepan, we have white sauce with chunks of sun-dried tomatoes, and in the pot, we have fettuccine pasta. I hope you're hungry. White sauce with tomatoes? Eek. Girl, you need to learn cooking. Hungry is an understatement, but if there's one thing more powerful than my stomach, it's my curiosity. Sarah, where did you get the money for all of this? And since when have you known how to cook? I go out of my way to cook your dinner and this is how you react? Fine then, I guess I'll just have to eat it all myself. I knew I should have stopped after the first question. Oh well, forget it. Sarah probably just borrowed some things from school or from one of her friends. Anyway, where have you been? Usually you'd have been home an hour ago. Shit, that's right. Given the situation, I hadn't even thought about what time it was. Let me look at my walkthrough. Nah, better just play it off. An excuse made up on the spot would just make her suspicious. Just at work? I must have lost track of time. Anyway, did I miss anything? Ah, now that you mention it, something did arrive for you. Sarah removed her apron, simultaneously taking out an envelope from her pocket. Sorry, I know I shouldn't have opened it. Sarah handed me the envelope, which she had attempted to reseal after opening. I peered inside the envelope, and within it I found money. Wait a minute, there was There has to be at least $2,000 in there. I spend a little on utensils and some fresh meat and vegetables. You can't eat instant food every day, instant noodles every day, you know. Sarah explained to me why the envelope was no longer full, but as I vacantly stared at the money in my hand, she needn't have bothered. Even at the pay I was promised, I should have made less than $1,000 in total, for there to be over double that left after Sarah's expenses. This must be Marcus's doing. He knows I need money and that I won't be able to pay him back unless I accept his job offer. Furthermore, Markus sent the money straight to my sister, eliminating the possibility of me refusing or returning the money. Yep, yeah, you can't return money you already used. Thank you, Sarah. But how did he get the money to my sister so early? Did he know ahead of time that Mudo would refuse to pay me? This is all just... What are you waiting for? Come on, get it where it's hot. Interrupting my agitated thoughts, Sarah took me by the hand and led me into the living room. Sitting on the table in front of the couch were placemats, paired with shiny cutlery, more goods we didn't own mere hours ago. Further to that, two steaming plates entered my vision. Moments later, Sarah made another quick stop in the kitchen, bringing with her a heavenly scent. Come on, put down the money and eat. As intrigued as I was by the scene before me, the thought of putting down the cash-filled envelope had yet to cross my mind. After all, before I could relax and eat dinner, there was still something I needed to clear up. I will, but before that, how and when did you get this envelope? Didn't your boss tell you the envelope was mailed to you sometime today? Well, I get that envelopes are made to be mailed, but an envelope with this much money in it? That's just careless and extremely suspicious. I hadn't really thought about that. Yes, you know, they do check contents. You shouldn't send to... You actually shouldn't send any money per post. Through post, but alright. I just found it slipped under the door before I got home. That is much to go on, but it does confirm my earlier suspicions. Sarah gets home hours before I do. If this money came from Markus, he really must have known what would happen ahead of time. Damn it! I feel like I'm being played by that bastard. Enough about that. Sit down and eat early, already. You'd better not be stalling because you're afraid to eat my cooking. What? Of course not. Though it is true that she's never cooked for me before. Oh well, it certainly smells nice enough. That's not hard. Cooking isn't hard. Wow, this is actually pretty good. It might be because I've been eating instant food for weeks on end, but this tastes like something I'd actually pay for. Actually, what I've learned is that most people that eat instant food on a daily basis can't enjoy normal foods unless you over spice them, because they are so used to the industrial spices and such things. But I have to say that I normally hate that chemical flavor that is in instant food. That's why I don't eat it. And when I hear people telling me, this instant sauce is so great, and I use it, and it's like, nah, thank you, but no thank you. I'll just create my own. Though it might taste better if a certain someone wasn't analyzing every bite I take. Maybe some feedback will get Sarah off my back. Wow, this is amazing. You really think so? Absolutely, you'll make a great wife one of these days. Eh? Jeez, what are you talking about? Who would be a great wife? Don't sell yourself short, my dear sister. Any guy would be lucky to have you. Though I suppose your attitude and sense of style could use some work. You really think that? Wait, what was that? You're the last person in the world who should be lecturing me on my style. No, I meant it as a compliment. How is that a compliment? Now this is more like it. Sarah is so much fun to tease, she's really easy to wind up. Whatever the case, it really is nice to be eating real food again. What are you talking about? It's only been a couple of weeks, you know. For you, maybe, but I've gone for a month of hospital food straight to nothing but instant noodles.
I
guess it has been a while for you. As much as I try to sympathize with Sarah, my life hasn't been so grand lately either. After suffering a severe head injury and losing I hate that word, especially in plural form, months worth of memories as a result, I received the grim news that our parents had been killed in a car crash. Worse, since the circumstances surrounding the crash were deemed suspicious, the assets were frozen, leaving Sarah and I without a dime. Finally, without any close relatives who we could rely on, I had little choice but to quit school and find a job, assuming responsibility for Sarah's well-being. So now, after suffering so much hardship in such a short amount of time, being able to indulge in a peaceful home life like this is a dream come true. Either way, you're right, it is nice. It feels like we've finally gotten some piece of our old life back. I couldn't agree with you more. And with that in mind, dear sister, what will be the next step of the Tesla family restoration project? The what? If we're going to restore our lives to what they were, we need to plan out what we're going to do. What's next? A car? A bigger TV? A live-in mate? How old are you guys? Like I'd let you get a live-in mate, you pervert. But you do have a point, we should have some kind of plan to manage from now on. What do we need next? There are a lot of things still missing from this house. The facilities work, and we have minor luxuries like a television and refrigerator. And this doesn't look like one of those cheap ones. I'm trying to figure out what brand it is. I don't know. And refrigerator, but it's still far way off feeling like home. It's not something we need to figure out right now. Just give it some thought. Right. I shouldn't get too excited about spending money we don't even have yet. Besides, we should be going to bed soon anyway, so... Right, we should get a second bed. Why isn't she working part-time or something? Huh? I mean, even if there's only one bedroom in this house, there's still room for another bed. That way we wouldn't need to share it anymore. That house didn't look like there's only room for one bedroom. I'm sorry, but... It didn't look like that. I'm sure many people would get the wrong idea if I said that I sleep with my sister, but there's really nothing dubious at play here. This house only has a single bedroom, and until now we couldn't afford a second bed. Furthermore, when I suggested that I take the couch, Sarah insisted that I needed to sleep properly for work, and I could tell that she didn't want to be left alone enough in an unfamiliar house. Given the situation, I'd say our decision was correct. That's a waste of money. It is. But don't you want a bed of your own again? I mean, surely you're sick of... Focus on things we need, not things we want. Besides, it's getting late. We should think about it tomorrow. Huh. I guess my idea wasn't as bright as I thought. Or there might be a different reason. Maybe Sarah isn't ready to sleep alone yet after all. Regardless, Sarah was right about one thing. We shouldn't get too excited about spending money we don't even have yet. I should have told Sarah where that money came from and what there might not be, that there might not be any future payments like this, but I let the atmosphere go to my head, afraid to break the mood. For the first time since our parents died, Sarah was happy, and if tonight pans out, I'd be satisfied with merely prolonging her happiness, even just temporarily. After taking a shower and storing my earnings, I retreated to my bedroom for a few hours of sleep. Sarah fell asleep by my side, tightly clinging to my torso, greedily stealing my body heat until I too lost consciousness. Unfortunately, as nice as a peaceful, relaxing night in a warm bed sounds, tonight that pleasure will be short-lived. Whatever Markus has planned, midnight is the deadline he gave me, and I don't plan on being late. Midnight meetings and corpse handling aside, the fact of the matter is that Markus has already compensated me for work not yet done, not to mention the promise of more to come. Whatever reservations I have about this, I can't afford not to go. At the very least, I need to hear him out and see what he has in mind. And if the job he has lined up for me is as violent and well paid as my night so far would suggest, then there are worse ways to make a living. Eyeing the clock on the wall facing our bed, I snuck away from my sister's side, careful not to wake her. I slowly removed her arms from around me, replacing my body with I had been using until moments prior, then tiptoed out of the bedroom and through the living room, not making a sound the entire trip. It's a shame to have to leave her side like this, but tonight, there's somewhere else I need to be. Following the unfamiliar route detailed to me early in the day, I made my way to a part of town I never thought I'd need to visit. Among the many districts of Richmond, this is one of the poorest and definitely not a good place to be at this time of the night. There's no police presence to speak of. Most of the stores are closed or abandoned, and there's absolute zero maintenance going on. As soon as Markus told me where we'd be meeting, I knew the job he had lined up for me couldn't be legal. Duh! Just what am I getting myself into here? Jeez, took you long enough. I was beginning to think you'd chicken out. The moment Markus and I met face to face, he opened with his usual level of compassion. Chickened out of what? I don't even know why I'm here. You're here because it's one of the few places in town where someone like you can actually make money. You know, that isn't what I meant. I'm in a shady neighborhood in the middle of the night prepared to make money from legally questionable work, and you're still only telling me the bare minimum. You can't keep me in the dark forever, Markus. I guess you're right. But really, relax already. It's honest work, I assure you. In this part of town, this late at night. I doubt it. Alright, so what now? Just follow me. You'll understand soon enough. Markus turned around and walked to the side entrance of the building adjoining the car park. He removed a key ring from his pocket and unlocked a steel frame door, turning back for a moment to smirk as though daring me to follow him. And so I did. Following right behind Markus, I entered the dreary building, immediately confronted by a dusty staircase within. The path before us was dark, dirty, and every bit as eerie as one would think a midnight stroll in an unsavory neighborhood might be. Despite that, the staircase appeared to be maintained, or at least not dilapidated. Moreover, albeit faint, I could definitely see light coming from below. Fighting? Oh, what awaited us at the bottom of the staircase was an arena. In the center was a boxing ring, and beyond that were grandstands akin to those I'd usually see in football stadiums. Despite the massive size of the venue before us, there were only a few other people present, all mulling around near the top of the grandstands. The lights remained dim, and for all intents and purposes, Markus and I were essentially alone. So, what do you think? Pretty impressive, huh? That's one word for it. What the hell is an arena like this doing down here? I believe the word you're looking for is stadium or ring. Anyway, where else would it be? Events like these can't take place out in the open, you know? Not even in Richmond. Events like these? It's just a boxing ring, right? In a way. Interested? In boxing? I'm not a fan of watching sport, but come to think about it. Just wait a little longer. Another 5 minutes in this place will be open to the public. Then you can tell me if you're interested in bashing skulls for a living. All right. Well, Markus and I hung around the bottom of the dark stairwell, and an entrance apparently reserved for staff, spectators began to storm in from between the grandstands. Hundreds, if not thousands, of spectators flooded the grandstands, soon filling the arena, which had been empty only minutes ago. The grandstands were filled, the ring gained fighters, and best of all, the betting began. Holy crap, look at all that money! Just how much are those people betting? Despite being so far away from the action, I could clearly see large stacks of money changing hands. Spectators practically threw money at the staff taking bets, growing all the more excited as the fighters for the first match began warming up.
Figures you'd jump straight to that. Yes, there's that side of the business, and yes, a lucky man can make himself a small fortune down here, but competing is where the real money is, and there aren't any rules against betting on yourself either. So, let me ask you again, are you interested?
Interested in that kind of money? Absolutely! But as far as competing goes, I could never do that. I don't think so. I'd rather be one of the people outside the ring collecting money.
Your loss. But if that's how you feel, then I suggest you set your sight on the man above the grandstand to your left.
Despite our poor vantage point, I did as Markus suggested and gazed towards the grandstand to the left of the boxing ring. Above the grandstand was a glass panel, a viewing booth, with a single shadow being cast from within.
Behind that bulletproof glass is the owner of his fine establishment, Mr. Caress.
Crow? Mr. Crow, are you? Okay.
Impress him and you can make a comfortable living without ever setting foot inside the ring.
Now that is worth nothing. Noting, a place like this must rake it in. I'd be foolish not to try and get in on something like this. Make a living. How? What kind of business does he run?
Forget I said anything. Let's just make a silly bet between friends, okay? Who do you think will win this next match? Macho Man or the Little Chap?
Okay. With both fighters for the next match already center stage, I could clearly tell who Markus was referring to. Before us were two men in their 30s, one in blue trunks and one in red. In blue was a Caucasian male. From my position, he appeared to be at least 6 foot tall, with the shoulder wide to match his impressive stature. His opponent seemed to be a head shorter, a Japanese man with a slim build, probably a martial artist of some variety.
I'm sure they're both professionals, given their presence here, but if I'm asked to choose the victor, I'd say... Fuck off, Markus, I don't gamble.
Fine, suit yourself.
After talking Markus out of making a bet, the two of us waited in silence for the match to begin. Even if we wanted to talk, it took enough concentration to simply observe from such a distance, let alone speak. If not for the significant difference in stature. I doubt I'd have even been able to tell the fighters apart. The instant the bell rang, the outcome had already been decided. In a split second, the massive concussion swept his opponent's leg, sending him to the floor. He then threw his legs around the Japanese man's arm, pushing against his elbow like a lever as it threatened to snap. The Japanese man cried out in pain as his arm bent backwards at the elbow, but his screams were overpowered by the crowd, who shouted out for blood, spurring on the giant he had been pitted against. The man in blue paid no heed to his opponent's pleas for mercy. Even with the Japanese man cried out in pain, forfeiting, without hesitation, the giant continued unabated, glaring at his opponent without even a hint of sympathy. Despite how overwhelmingly one side of the fight proved to be, the crowd continued to cheer, seemingly more interested in seeing blood than a match. And so, in response to their lust for violence, the concussion man happily cried, carried out his job. The sound of the Japanese man's arm being snapped in two was silenced by the crowd, most of whom went quiet as its echo reached their ears. Medical staff rushed into the ring, carrying the fallen fighter out post-haste, and gamblers lined up to collect the payouts, leaving the remainder of those present in shock and awe.
Well, that was unpleasant. Matches aren't usually this brutal. There's no money to be made in excessively one-sided fights.
Markus tried to speak to me, but whatever he had to say, I wasn't interested. Even after the match had ended, my mind was in the ring replaying the scene that had transpired mere moments ago. I could feel the blood drain from my face even before the decisive moment, at which point there wasn't a single hair on my body not standing on end. Markus tricked me here with promises of money, making it sound like my worries were over. A legal job, one in which I could act violently and make money from doing so. Boxing fit that description, and for a moment here, I could even see myself wearing boxing gloves and trunks, duking it out with some other money-hungry athlete. But what I just saw, whatever it was, that's not happening. Markus can't possibly expect me to get in a ring like that, getting my legs broken for his sadistic boss's amusement. I may be desperate, but no sum of money is worth that. After the last of the spectators and staff members had left the stadium, only two fighters lingered in the underground lair, hidden behind thick clouds, watching over the match from afar. The duo began to wind down as the night's festivities came to a close. Yeah, what a night. I can't even remember the last time I watched a fight live. Were they always this gruesome? The betting are usually more balanced. There's no profit in matches with obvious outcomes after all. Usually, as in not tonight. Do you have to ask? You specifically requested that we school the pairings so that different weight classes would fight one another.
I do. That doesn't sound like me.
Well, you didn't put it quite like that. You wanted to find someone lean, fast and strong, right? Someone who could punch above their weight class.
Ah, right, right. But isn't this selection method a little counterproductive? Why are you asking me? It was your idea. Oh, I see. Well, scratch that. There has to be a less costly method, right? Huh. Yes, sir. I'll start spreading word that we are recruiting, and I'll keep your criteria in mind. No, no, no. You can't pin this one on me. It's your criteria, so I wouldn't have a clue what to look for. Very well. I'll pass along my criteria and expand the recruitment drive to include younger fighters. Even then, it might take a while. Finding someone capable is only half the battle. The real challenge is finding someone who is not only emotionally and mentally stable, but also desperate for money. And ruthless enough to kill for it. Yeah, no. That was no Japanese accent, I'm sorry. Chapter 2, Sadist. Well, this part is long enough. The next day, yes. We won't get into this. Don't worry. We'll find out what happened on Tuesday morning, September 6th. In the next part. I hope you enjoyed it. And I see you next time. Bye!